Welcome back as we continue part two of our series on security and encryption. So what happens when you connect to a web page and you have to, say, type in your password or your credit card number? How can you make sure your private data is secure from prying eyes? Alice has loaded a web page from Bob's server into her web browser. This web page has a login form where Alice types her username and password. When she hits submit, these will be transmitted to Bob's server. But how can Alice be sure that Eve won't see what her password is in case she's snooping on the line? We talked about how Bob should secure passwords on his server by hashing them, but the password hasn't made it to Bob's server yet. It has to be transmitted across the internet first. In the ordinary course of events, Alice's password will be sent across the network in plain text. This is bad. Especially if Alice is on an open Wi-Fi network in her favorite coffee shop. If Eve is on the same coffee shop, on the same Wi-Fi network, she'd be able to grab Alice's password no problem. Ordinary web pages have a URL that begins with http://. Any web page that begins with this prefix is not secure. To be secure, the URL has to begin with https://. That means that there's an encrypted connection between Alice's computer and Bob's server that hopefully Eve won't be able to snoop on. But that's not the whole story. When Alice submits the form containing her password, that form is sent to a URL that Alice generally doesn't see. Even if she's on a web page that begins with HTTPS, if the form gets sent over HTTP unencrypted, it does no good. Most browsers nowadays will warn you before you send form data over an unencrypted connection, and there's also an option in LastPass you can turn on to have it do the same. But it may not work all the time if there's some funky JavaScript going on as well. And even after all that, it's possible for a web page to have what's called mixed content. So, Alice is viewing a web page that begins with HTTPS. This web page has images on it. Those images are loaded with their own URL. If an image's URL begins with http://, then even though the rest of the web page is encrypted on the way to Alice's machine, that image isn't, and Eve can see it. Which isn't a problem unless the image contains private or embarrassing data. What is a problem is what's known as mixed active content. Active content is something that, unlike an image, actually runs code in the browser. It could be a bit of JavaScript, or it could be something like a Flash video. Active content has the opportunity to interact with other elements in the web page, which is really handy for making quality interactive web applications. But mixed active content means that there is insecure active content coming over insecure HTTP, on a secure web page encrypted via HTTPS. If this insecure content gets private data from a secure portion of the website, then that private data can be sent unencrypted over the network, and Eve can see it easily. Most browsers nowadays block or at least warn about mixed active content. Alice can help herself out by making sure she connects via HTTPS anywhere she can. The Electronic Frontier Foundation, a nonprofit group dedicated to supporting privacy and defending civil liberties in the digital world, has developed a browser extension called HTTPS Everywhere, available in Firefox with extensions for Chrome and Opera currently in beta. This extension will completely automatically look at all of the web pages Alice goes to and see if it's available via HTTPS. If so, it takes her there automatically. That's all well and good, but how does HTTPS make Alice's web browsing secure? Initially, it used a protocol called SSL, Secure Sockets Layer. This protocol is now obsolete and unsafe. The new version is called Transport Layer Security, or TLS. But just due to momentum, people still refer to it as SSL, or sometimes SSL/TLS. The important thing is to make sure your browser always supports the latest version of the protocol so that you aren't vulnerable to security holes of the past. The website howsmyssl.com will show you this. Just because of the way security people think, the absolute best rating your browser can get is probably okay. This means that you're as safe as you can be, but they say probably because who knows how many security vulnerabilities there are waiting to be discovered. If there are problems with your browser, it'll give you a lower rating and a description of what's wrong. The main thing to worry about is your TLS version. As long as it's using the latest version, you're good. Also, compression should be turned off, since this can lead to information leaks. Also important is the cipher suite your browser supports. We'll talk a little about this later, but your browser should support the most modern and secure ciphers while not supporting older, insecure ciphers. And your client should also support ephemeral keys, which we'll talk about later when we cover perfect forward secrecy. Okay, but how does it actually work? I hear you cry. It uses something called the Public Key Infrastructure, or PKI. Remember that public key cryptography uses an asymmetric key pair, a public key that can encrypt data and verify signatures, and a private key that can decrypt data and make digital signatures. It begins with, and lives or dies by, a certificate, called an X.509 certificate. Bob creates his public-private key pair and sends his public key to a certificate authority, or CA, to generate the certificate. The CA then verifies his identity and his public web server and generates the certificate, which he loads into his web server software. When Alice connects to his server, she gets the certificate and uses that to verify his identity. She can do this because the CA has its own public key, which it used to digitally sign the certificate. But what good does that do? Doesn't that just push the problem back a step? Yes, it does. So now, instead of trusting that she's connected to Bob's server, she has to trust the CA when the CA says she's connected to Bob's server. So the CA has a certificate that's signed by another CA. This won't work for long. We have to terminate the sequence somewhere. And it all terminates with CAs that are called root CAs. These are CAs that are trusted directly by the web browsers, and their public keys are hard-coded into the web browser software. Generally, these root CAs are well trusted, but it has happened in the past that some root CAs have stopped being trusted and removed from the browser software. This is another reason it's important to use a secure browser, generally Firefox or Chrome, and basically any browser except IE, and keep it up to date. It's also possible for a certificate to be cross-signed, that is, signed by more than one CA. This increases the trust of the certificate, since even if one CA isn't trusted, as long as the other one is, it's still good. And a certificate signed by two trusted CAs is more trustworthy than one signed by either CA individually. Assuming we can trust the CA, then we can trust Bob's certificate. His certificate is good for a certain length of time, usually 2 or 3 years, and then has to be replaced. This is to minimize the chances of the certificate being compromised. Hopefully, by the time Eve gets anywhere close to cracking it, Bob has a new certificate and public key. But if something happens along the way, and Bob's key gets compromised before the certificate expires, the key can be revoked. Bob can spot the problem and request that his CA revoke the key, or if the CA is really on the ball, they can spot it and revoke it on their own. The latter is what happened in the case of Lavabit, when Ladar Levison was ordered by the courts to turn over all of the private keys his customers were using. He was also ordered not to revoke them, but his CA, GoDaddy, received no such court order, and they promptly revoked all of the keys belonging to Lavabit. So when Levison turned back on the service for a few days so his clients could download their emails, they were doing so with revoked certificates. Here's the problem. Some browsers, most notably Chrome, don't check to see if a certificate has been revoked before using it. And there have been a couple of attempts by security professionals to set up test sites with a deliberately revoked key so that users could test whether or not the browser successfully detected that the key was revoked. Of all the major browsers, only Firefox worked like it should, and did so on all platforms, including Android. Chrome was the worst offender. Not only is revocation checking disabled by default, and it's the only web browser that does so, they recently removed the checkbox to enable it, and now it's only available as a complicated hidden setting. And even so, they don't have it as a hard fail option, meaning it won't show you the web page. Even if you do manage to get it turned on, they'll give you a red warning in the URL bar, but show the web page anyway. And to make matters worse, they very quickly updated Chrome to appear to recognize the revoked certificates on those test sites by blacklisting the domain, so the test will appear to work even though it won't work with actual revoked certificates. The lesson to take from this is that Firefox is by far the safest browser on the web, which does the most to protect your privacy. Unfortunately, it's not available on iOS, so if you're using an iPhone or iPad, use Safari, not Chrome, and even then, be ever watchful. So now we have the certificate, and we need to set up the encrypted tunnel so that Alice can communicate securely with Bob's server. The traditional way has been to use an exchange of random numbers using a method called RSA Rivest-Shamir-Adelman to do this exchange, which is known as a handshake. Alice's browser sends a client hello to Bob's server, with a random number she's chosen and a list of ciphers she supports. Eve, whom we're assuming is snooping on the network, gets this random number. Bob's server sends a server hello back to Alice's browser with a random number of its own, which ciphers were selected, and the SSL certificate. Eve gets this too. Alice's browser responds with a pre-master secret. This is encrypted with Bob's public key, so Eve cannot get it. Both Alice and Bob now use both random numbers and the pre-master secret to generate the master secret, which is used to make the session key. Since Eve doesn't have the pre-master secret, she can't generate the master secret without doing an extensive cryptanalysis, which hopefully will take her trillions of years. The session key is the symmetric key for the bulk cipher, or the cipher that will be used to encrypt the actual transmission. If Eve does somehow manage to crack this session key, since it's only valid for that session, she can only read the data for that session. The next time Eve connects, an entirely new session key is generated, and Eve has to start all over again. So the connection is now secure, unless Eve manages to get a hold of Bob's private key. Say she records the encrypted data, including the handshake, and then later strong-arms Bob into giving up his private key, perhaps using her position in the network snooping association. She can then read every conversation she recorded with everyone who connected to Bob's server. The fix for this is something that's now supported by all major browsers and is slowly becoming adopted by web servers. Perfect forward secrecy. This is using those ephemeral keys we mentioned earlier. Basically, since Alice trusts Bob's certificate, then instead of using Bob's public key to exchange the pre-master secret, they can generate it using ephemeral keys, which are keys that are created on the fly and discarded as soon as the master secret is agreed upon. The standard for doing this is to use a Diffie-Hellman exchange, which works something like this. Alice and Bob agree to a particular kind of prime number, called a safe prime. A safe prime is a prime that's equal to 2 times a prime number plus 1. We'll use 23 as an example. Each safe prime has a number of bases. They also agree on one of these base numbers, say 3. Eve gets both of these numbers. Alice chooses a random number, let's say 7. Bob chooses one as well, let's say it's 13. They keep these numbers to themselves. They then employ modulo division. Remember from part 1 that modulo division is where you divide the numbers and use the remainder as the result. So they'll take the base, raise it to the power of their random number, and mod it with the safe prime. So Alice calculates 3 to the power of 7 mod 23, which is 2. Bob calculates 3 to the power of 13 mod 23, which is 9. They then exchange these numbers with each other, and Eve gets them. Here's the clever part. Alice takes the 9 she got from Bob and raises it to the power of her random number, 7, and mods it with 23 to get 4. Bob takes the 2 he got from Alice and raises it by his random number, 13, and mods it with 23 to get 4. They both get the same result, and always will. They can now use this result as the pre-master secret and generate the master secret from that as before and encrypt the session. In order to calculate this result, you need at least one of the random numbers initially generated by Alice or Bob. But since Eve doesn't have either one of those since they were never transmitted, she has no way of doing this. And since those random numbers are discarded as soon as the handshake is complete, she can't use her NSA position to strong-arm either of them into giving it to her. She's left with brute forcing it. Now for this example, we've used smaller numbers to make the math clear, but since there are only going to be 23 possible keys with our method, Eve could crack that in no time. In the real world, Alice and Bob's machines use an enormous safe prime and really large random numbers to make the calculation, which should take Eve longer than the age of the universe to crack. Using a safe prime helps because it greatly increases the group of numbers Eve will have to go through when doing her cryptanalysis. So now we have our encrypted connection, and even if Eve records the conversation, there's absolutely nothing Bob can give her that will allow her to decrypt it. Now, how can you tell if your connection is sufficiently encrypted and uses perfect forward secrecy? In Chrome, this shows up as a padlock next to the URL. If there's no padlock, it's not encrypted. A green padlock means everything is okay. And if the website has an extended validation certificate, the organization name will appear in green next to it. A gray padlock with a yellow triangle means that there's insecure content on the page, which could mean there's a loophole allowing information leakage. And if the padlock has a red X and there's a red line through the HTTPS, then there's either very risky, insecure content on the page, or there's a problem with the site's certificate. Clicking on the icon will give you information about the site, and if you click on the connection tab, you can see things like the TLS version, which as of this video's creation should be 1.2. But how do you tell if it uses perfect forward secrecy? What you're looking for is ephemeral Diffie-Hellman ciphers. These are ciphers that will contain either DHC or EDH in the name. For example, ECDHE is Elliptic-Curve Diffie-Hellman Exchange, which uses perfect forward secrecy and very secure elliptic-curve cryptography to generate the keys. It's quite a bit different from the Diffie-Hellman exchange we just saw. In this case, Bob's server uses elliptic-curve cryptography to generate a new public key which he sends to Alice, signed with the public key in his server certificate. Once Alice verifies that this new public key is from Bob, she generates one of her own and sends it to Bob's server. They then use these keys to communicate the parameters for the master secret. Elliptic curve cryptography is so secure that a 224-bit key generated via elliptic curve cryptography is considered to be as strong as a 2048-bit RSA key. This makes ECDHE one of the most secure key exchange methods currently available. In Firefox, checking the security of a website is actually a bit easier because you can install an extension called Calomel, which shows you a shield next to the address bar, color-coded to the level of security the site has. Gray means no encryption, red is weakest, yellow is a bit stronger, blue is stronger still, and finally, green is most secure. It will show you clearly all elements of the certificate and encryption, including the ciphers used and whether or not it uses perfect forward secrecy. They'll also tell you individually how each component scores. So we have a good certificate and a strong encrypted connection with perfect forward secrecy. But as always, it's important to know what's being encrypted and what isn't. The body of the web page is being encrypted. The request to the host isn't. This means that while Eve can't see the content of the web page Alice went to, she can still see what website she went to. Take a look at the URL for the first video in this series. If you go to this URL, Eve won't be able to get any of the data on the web page. She won't be able to tell which video you saw. But she will be able to tell that you went to YouTube. She can follow you all around the internet, seeing which websites you visit. So extra steps need to be taken if Alice is on an open Wi-Fi connection or if she otherwise wants to prevent being snooped on. We'll cover that in the next video, and in the video after that, we'll finish part 2 by covering other ways of authenticating to websites and how to make logins more secure.